Okay, so let's start. So the title is a title to catch the developers. Maybe you don't want to get rid of your DBA and send the database into a burnout. So we will see the best practice and the bad practices in microservice architecture. I'm Frank Pachot. I'm working at CERN. I've been working with databases, mainly Oracle, for more than 20 years. In development environments and operation environments. This presentation is more about what I've seen doing consulting in different environments rather than what I'm currently doing at CERN. So the idea first, when I was in the development team and interacting with architects or developers, I've heard a lot that database is always a problem, and I tried to understand what is really the problem, what's the difference with the database when we compare that with an application server. And then we will go through the different architecture that we have seen in the last decades, from monolithic to microservices today. And a little demo to show the problems that can happen and maybe the solution and actually the things we need to think about when going to microservices for database application, for an application that needs to store data in the database. So database is always a problem. Three properties of the database that you do not find in other applications: it's shared, it contains persistent data, so stateful, and you interact with SQL, and that can be a problem for some people. I will go through those three points. First, it is shared, which means that the database is accessed by many people, multiple users, at the same time, concurrency, and doing very different things. Some are inciting data in bulk, some are updating some rows somewhere, some are running big queries. The fact that it's shared means that in production, it's easy to have one big database that you share with everybody, or if you don't do that, you will need to replicate and then think about consistency in that case. In development, the fact that the database is shared is a problem. Do you give one database for each developer, one copy of production or maybe of anonymized data, or do you have your developers sharing the same databases? It can be interesting to let them share the same database, so at least they will see some concurrency problem. Very few people are really testing the concurrent scenarios in UAT. But of course, if you want to be agile, you prefer to have your own database where you can do everything that you want. Then comes the idea of microservices. Instead of sharing one big database, you try to divide in smaller components because it's easier to organize. Not only to organize the database, but the teams who will work on it. So smaller components, they have an identified owner, and it's easier to manage that. As long as they do not have data in common, because then you have the problem with the shared database. I'm sorry, this blue points. Okay. If you need to share some data, then you have to go to replication asynchronously if you want to remove the dependency between them, and then you have new problems. And this is a diagram. This is not the worst I've seen. This is only the one that fits in a PowerPoint. That was not microservices, just a few databases at a customer and all the many database links between those databases. And you can imagine that it's a mess to manage. You don't know where to start if you want to restart a database, if you restore something. If you are already in that kind of thing, you cannot go to microservices just dividing more. What you need is loosely coupled and no cyclical dependency between the services. So it's not only about dividing the monolithic database, but being able to have things that do not share too much in common. That's about sharing the data. The second property that can be a problem is that it needs to be persistent. The application server, you don't care. You can restart it, start many instances of it. But here, the data must stay forever, and forever can mean years and decades. So with multiple services, then you may have a problem. You need to think about persistency. For example, for legal reason, you may have today to restore the data as of 10 years ago. With a monolithic database where all the code is in the database, you just restore that and you have all data consistent and even the code, the stored procedure to make sense out of this data. If you have multiple services running in different technologies where maybe the backup were done differently, and if you have that today and you need to restore some data in 10 years, that will be complex. And if the code is not in the database, you will also have to find the version of the application that can make sense out of the data that is stored. It can be even worse with non-structured data where you need the code or you cannot interpret it. So the fact that it's persistent means that in microservices it will be easier if all the changes are done in only one place, because this is the place that you will backup. That's the idea of CQRS, where you have one service for the update and then replicas for queries. But you need also to think about consistency. So persistent, think also about the code that is not in the database, and you may have many language, many technologies. Unstructured data will be worse. It's better if you have data that can be self-described, like the relational model or XML or something else. Maybe you can just restore the data without the application, but if you don't have that, that will be also a problem. And the third property, SQL. So SQL, for a lot of us, is a very nice language. It's a fourth generation language. It operates on a set of rows, so for performance, that's very good. It works on normalized database. If you attended to Marcus Winant's session yesterday, he explained that the data model in a relational database is made only for the data, not knowing the way it will be queried. And the database that is shared may have multiple purpose queries. So many things good about SQL, but actually today it seems to be too complex for today's development cycles. And people go back to what was before SQL and relational was invented. So we see more and more hierarchical structures, XML, JSON, BSON, that are the opposite of the multi-purpose model. And we see more and more things done on data in procedural languages, Java, Python, rather than running that in SQL in the database. And we have object relational mapping to hide this complexity. So it's complex. The other problem, it's not really portable. What you write in SQL, there are standards, but what you write in SQL will not work the same in any database. Even worse, when you put procedural codes, because those are specific to the database vendor. And the problem I've seen, many customers who wanted to go microservices, their main problem was actually the cost of the database system, licensing, and the cost of the development, because SQL developers are rare and expensive. So the reason to go microservices has nothing to do with performance. It has to do with organization, smaller teams, who requires less skills in database and SQL. They have only development skill for procedural languages and try to do that. So that's what we see today, and microservices can be a solution for some of them, but we will see the different problem. Now about the history. So before, we had those monolithic servers where the data and the business logic, the code, was running in a big system, and only the GUI part was another component. So that was easy to maintain, only one thing for the operation, but not very flexible. And this is where people came to client server, putting all the logic in the application tier. Then it was very agile at that time. You can choose any language, you can choose anything. So we had this agility except for the deployment, because that was a nightmare to deploy the code in all user computers. And then the idea was to put the code in the middle in an application server. Actually, many users with the GUI, many user computer with the GUI, some application servers, and still one database. And then came the idea of microservices. We have divided the GUI, we have divided the application, and now we try to divide also the database to dedicate smaller databases to each service. And then I will talk about the communication between those components, because that looks good in a PowerPoint, but physically those components need to communicate. And this is where I will show you a demo. It's not there. Okay, it does move away, but I will. Okay, so this demo, I will run it with Oracle, with a special version in beta of Oracle. I will explain why later. And my idea is to run something, the most simple service. I will create a table with customers and accounts, and with an amount for each account. And I want to create a service to transfer money from one account to another one, and to run that for a lot of accounts, also to see the performance and the time it takes. Okay, I will skip that. I connect with SQL CL, the Oracle client, and I will create my tables. A table with customers, a table with accounts, just a customer ID and an amount, and I will insert some data there. Going quickly on that. And 300,000 accounts, that's finally what I want to see. This is how it looks like, the 10 first rows. So everybody has $10,000, euros, in its account, and I have 300,000 accounts there. So my idea will be, I want to move €1 from all the accounts to the first one, and I will build a service and call it for each of them. And I will show you how we can put the code in the database or in the client and in different languages. But first, I will do all that in one SQL statement. If I don't want to have a unit service to transfer from one amount to the other, if my goal is to transfer €1 from all accounts to the first one, I can update all amounts, except the first one I decrease by one, and I credit all this number to the first one. And those are just two commands, and they are atomic because I commit at the end. And I have a script that I've run before and after that just looks at the CPU time used for that. We will see that running on in top below. 4 seconds for that. So I have an idea that doing that takes 4 seconds of CPUs. But, so let's check the results. Everybody has given €1 to the first account. I roll back to reset my test case. And now we will see how to do that without SQL. Still with SQL, but the loop on all these accounts will be in a procedural code to have a function defined with that. And we will show the advantage. And first, because I am on a NoSQL database, I will create a stored procedure to have that running in the database, like in the SmartDB concept, like in monolithic databases. Just a procedure that takes an account to debit, an account to credit, and the amount. And so for each call, it will just update the amount to debit and credit the second account. Why doing that instead of SQL SQL statement? Well, we have seen that people do not like SQL, but also this is easier to maintain. If one day the business decides that they want to add a commission on each transfer, I don't want to add something in all queries. I just want a service, a procedure where I will add this additional business logic. So that can be a reason to get a small service for that. And now I will run the same. So I set my CPU timer. And what I execute here is a select on them and call that transfer for all of them. And you can see it running in top here, 100% in CPU. Only one process is running in CPU, the session process here, because everything is running in the database there. The loop and the transfer function, because that's a stored procedure. We can see that it is longer to do the same work, but it is doing the same work row by row. Actually, we are running in the same process there, but there are two engines in this process, the SQL engine and the PLSQL engine, and the code has to switch the context in each loop from one engine to the other, and this is why it takes a bit longer. And longer, it's still CPU time. It's not idle time waiting for latency. That's CPU time switching the context before doing something in SQL and then switching to do it in PLSQL. Okay, so we have finally the same result, and I will roll back to go back to the next step. The rollback is still done only by SQL, so only a few seconds there. But today, people do not want to write things in PLSQL because it's hard to find people, cheap developers in PLSQL. It's easier to find developers in Java or JavaScript or Python. And this is why I will run the same thing in JavaScript. So here, the SQLCL client I have can run, it's actually running in Java, and it can run some JavaScript, and this is where I will define that. But the loop will run on the client side. So that's just the connection. And I build a script just to show the account, to be sure that I start with the same amount for everybody. And then I will build my transfer function. So my transfer function will need to update each account. And it takes the account and the amount. And it will run the statements for those values. So this is my transfer function, my transfer service. And I will call that in a loop for each account. Exactly the same as I did in PLSQL, procedural code to do that. I set the timer, and I run that. So the big difference now, I'm still using 100% of my CPU, but from two processes. This is the database process, and this is the client process. And you see that both of them are running, and they cannot run at the same time, because you have a loop calling the database, and when the database is okay, the client continues with the next account. So they cannot be optimized to use 100% of CPUs, because one has to wait when the other is running. And you have more latency. Before, in PL/SQL, you had that context switch between two engines running in the same process. Now you have a context switch between two processes. And in real life, it's worse, because here I'm running on the same server, I'm even on the same Docker container. If I put those two in different containers, that will increase all this this time. But this time is still CPU. I'm running full CPU there, and in total. And something that we can see also, we will see the time used in CPU. Another reason that I've heard not to use stored procedure is that Oracle is expensive, I don't want to and I pay my licenses on the CPU power I have, and I don't want to use those expensive CPU cycles just to run something that I can run in Java elsewhere. And here what we see, so it has finished after nearly 2 minutes, and we can see that in total I've spent more than 1 minute CPU time in the database, and more than 30 seconds CPU time in the client. So if you think that moving the code out of the Oracle database will save you some CPU power and some CPU licenses on the database, that's wrong. Because the switch of context that happens in the server has that cost, which is higher than just running everything in the database. So that's interesting, just checking that the result is the one I expected. And I call the rollback from there. Still quick, because the rollback operates on the set of rows. So from the client, it's longer. And in real life, you will add the network latency, all the virtualization layers, everything. Now, what I will show you is something that is not yet in production from Oracle. It's a beta version. And the idea, you don't want to write PL/SQL, because that's not cool, developers are too expensive. You want to write some JavaScript. But you don't want to run that in the client, because we have seen that it takes more time and more CPU cycles on both sides. So what if we run JavaScript directly in the database? And that's what Oracle is going to do. If you attended the session yesterday on GraalVM, the same team is putting this engine in the database. And this is a beta version, which is public. You can download it and test it. And I will run the same now, creating a stored procedure in JavaScript. So new syntax there to declare some source code. I go fast, it's really similar to what I've run from the client. Here I just load my code, JavaScript code, and then I create a stored procedure, but not in PL/SQL, language is JavaScript, and the code is the code I've loaded there. If I query my procedures, I can see them, and I can run them, of course. I call the demo one. So I have two procedures. One will do the loop, and the other one is my individual service that transfers an amount from one account to the other. So now we can see that we are back to 100% CPU only in the Oracle process, so in the database. This avoids all the latency switching between the client and the server, and this avoids all the context switch between processes. But we are still running in two engines, between SQL and the multilingual engine that is there. That's the second beta. The first beta was, of course, a bit longer than PL/SQL because PL/SQL is optimized for decades, but not so long. The second beta is longer. Here, my goal is not to look at the time because that's a beta. They will optimize it. I think that between the first beta and the second beta, they had to add some code to make it safer between the two engines, and now they will optimize it. So we will not look at the time it takes because it just takes a few minutes. The important thing, everything runs 100% in the database in the language that you want. And the goal of Oracle, they use their Polyglot engine, so the goal is to implement JavaScript. You can do also some Python in there in the beta, and maybe something else later. I'm going back to the slides. So those are nearly the number. That was the number, the time taken in the first beta. The second beta takes a bit more than 2 minutes. So if you want, I have 2 blog posts about those tests with the first beta and the second beta, and then you can see the time. And you can run it, not in production for sure, that's a beta, but it's a public beta, you can download it. So what happens? Context switches. And this is what I call the database burnout when you have a lot of that. That was just a loop, but imagine many, many threads doing the same thing. This is exactly the same as when you are working on something and you have your boss coming and asking you something else, and then you receive the message, can you check that? And you are always switching between tasks. And finally, at the end of the day, you did nothing, but you were not idle. Exactly like that, you are not idle, you are on CPU, but finally you did nothing because the actual work here takes only 3 seconds. The same as I did with a SQL statement. If you want to get an idea about the time, the CPU cycles it takes for a context switch, I have a URL here where you can see the time it takes in CPU cycle for many operations that happen in your processor, and the context switch is there. And they compare it with the distance you can do at the speed of the light, because this is what you expect from the information in the processor. So we are in kilometers, and I compare the number of context switches that you can do, about 10,000 per second. I compare that to what we do at CERN in the LHC, where the protons are running at the speed of light, and they do 10,000 round trips every second. So if you wait on context switches, you are spending time on something that is at the scale of kilometers, and you can expect to be more efficient in a small processor. The URL for it. So now back to microservices, you can get where I want to go. You have communications between all them, and this communication as context switches, latency, anything, and you have to think about them when you design your microservices. You design them at logical level for your organization, but then you need to think at physical level where it will run because of this communication between them. And one first idea may be run them in the same physical component. It's still 2 engines, SQL and the multilingual engine, or SQL and PL/SQL, but if you can run that in the same process, physically that will be better. And maybe even regroup some microservices that you have divided for organizational reasons, but for the implementation, maybe you want to run them at the same place in the same container because of that. There, I come to some ideas of solutions, and I see two kind of solutions to do microservices with databases. The first one, if your database, your service is working on data that is not shared a lot with others, then if you want to collocate the code and the data for the problems we have seen, you can collocate that on directly on in the application. There are some databases that you can embed, which means that they run in the same process. You can do that with MongoDB, you can do that with SQLite, etc. So you do not share the information, but you can embed it. Think about the persistency. Maybe you need it or not. And there are probably many services which needs to operate on temporal data, temporal maybe a few days, that is not shared or can be asynchronously sent to other services. And that can be a solution to get the good performance for that. But for the others, for the data that must be shared, persistent, there is also the solution to run in the database. We have seen today PLSQL, for example, for Oracle. In a few years, maybe this multilingual engine, and you can do microservices running in the database. The idea of services is not linked to technology. So for a long time in a relational database, you can create procedures as packages, you can create views, you can have this separation, this modularization of everything. If you do not put database links everywhere and links everywhere, if you control them, you can run them on the database. And you can have, so the idea today with Oracle, you can do PLSQL. With Postgres, you can run many, many languages. In the future, you will have probably this multilingual engine. The idea of Oracle also is to put this multilingual engine in MySQL. So maybe some services with this new architecture, maybe some code will be back to the database for performance reasons and scalability reasons. Of course, all those problems I've seen comes from the fact that we are working row by row on them because we wanted to use this transfer function for everything. If you build another service to do the bulk processing, then you can write it more efficiently, like I did in SQL, and you don't have that problem with a switch of context because you do only a few of them. And in conclusion, so the first important thing is their PowerPoint is different than the physical implementation of it. And that's a shortcut we take to many times because of the short delivery cycles. You build something logically, and then you should think now how it works. It was good to separate things, but maybe they can run together. And that's also the idea of the multilingual engine, not only to be able to run new languages in the database, but the same language in any place. If you have a library, for example, that validates a credit card number, you don't want to write it. You have to write it on the client, you have to write it in the database, you have to write it in many places, and you want to write it in only one language and one library. And this is the idea. You write it without caring about where it will run, but then you will be able to deploy it where it will be the most efficient. And think about the services that access to the database. Think about them, what can be embedded with the code or where the code is better with the data. And something that's important, if you have to move data, it takes probably longer than moving the code. And the code, you deploy it only once. What time is it? Perfect. We have time for questions. How many of you are doing microservices with database applications? I'm not talking about something that do not share data or do not persist data there. I heard a lot of people, I've seen a lot of customers trying to go there, and when they implement it, they encounter exactly the same problem we encountered years ago in client-server. So it's still important to think about that. What happens in the process is still the same. Any question?
Why don't you use Pragma UDF in PL as well?
Why? Yeah, sure. I can. If I call it from SQL, yeah. Yeah, yeah. That solved the problem. If you call it from SQL. Here I wanted to show something more general, where you have a function that you can call from everything. But if you call PLSQL from SQL, the PLSQL can run in the same engine. And it solves many problems, not all, and you have also limitation. But yeah, Pragma UDF was a step further in that, to avoid those switch of contexts. Any questions?